Welcome to the 2016-17 Ice Hockey Rules and Officiating video. This video will provide guidance on points of emphasis this year, dealing with an enhanced standard of play and player safety, as well as focus on new rules for the upcoming season. In the summer of 2004, the NCAA Ice Hockey Rules Committee developed a directive to reclaim the rulebook and, in particular, address the obstruction and restraining fouls that were plaguing the game at that time. In an attempt to define a new standard of play, a simple guideline was articulated. Players who use illegal tactics to take away a legally gained advantage from an opponent must be penalized. The initial focus was on players away from the puck being illegally held up in their attempts to receive a pass or pursue a loose puck. In 2008, the focus shifted to the puck carrier, who increasingly was forced to fight through illegal contact. The Rules Committee believes that the habits of old have started to reappear in our game, and to address this, the points of emphasis for the new rulebook once again include standard of play. The Rules Committee has identified a number of target areas for officials to focus their attention and enforcement, allowing all players the right to meet their offensive and defensive responsibilities without being held, hooked, or otherwise obstructed is a principal goal. While the Rules Committee hopes to see increased offensive opportunities from this initiative, there is evidence that attacking players are also offenders in the area of obstruction, for example, face-off picks. The four specific target areas include offensive players moving through the neutral or offensive zones being unfairly or illegally held up while they make a legitimate attempt to get or remain open for a pass from a puck-controlling teammate. Offensive players moving through the neutral or offensive zones being unfairly or illegally held up while they attempt the legitimate pursuit of a loose puck. Players along the boards, on or away from the puck, being unfairly or illegally restrained. Puck carriers losing legitimate opportunities by the illegal use of sticks on hands, arms, hips, or other areas that compromise their ability to control the puck and create offensive opportunities. Note, the loss of possession is not required for a penalty to be called. In all areas of our game, the Rules Committee feels that a player who has gained a positional advantage on an opponent through the use of physical skill and/or anticipation shall not lose that advantage through the illegal use of hands, arms, or stick. Any player in pursuit of a puck or open lane shall not lose a perceived positional advantage by the illegal use of hands, arms, or stick by an opponent. If a player is deprived of that advantage by an illegal act, for example, a hook, hold, or interference, etc., the appropriate penalty must be called. Likewise, the puck carrier shall not have his or her opportunities compromised by an illegal action, regardless of how slight. Or, for example, if the puck carrier was able to take a shot on goal. If the puck carrier was compromised, the call must be made. The illegal acts, which will be given heightened attention for the upcoming season, include, but are not necessarily limited to, the following. Using a free or open hand or arm to restrain an opponent along the boards or in open ice. Using a free or open hand to grab any part of an opponent's uniform, equipment, or stick. Tying up an opponent by illegal use of hands, arms, or stick, rather than by body position. Picking or screening a player who does not have possession of the puck, and in the process, preventing the player from moving to open or unoccupied ice in any zone. And placing the stick between an opponent's legs, reducing that player's ability to participate in the play. The following are several examples with rulings to help apply the standard of play changes for 2016-17. This set of plays deals with play along the boards. A player may press and release along the boards with use of the free hand, but may not hold, wrap, or impede an opposing player's progress in any manner, for example, leg, hip, arm, etc. Coaches and players sometimes refer to these as a crowbar, can opener, or lasso maneuver. This includes players on or off the puck along the boards. This set of plays deals with dump and chase. Offensive players coming through the neutral or offensive zones must not be unfairly or illegally held up while they make a legitimate attempt to get or remain open for a pass from a puck-controlling teammate. Further, offensive players coming through the neutral or offensive zones must not be unfairly or illegally held up while they attempt the legitimate pursuit of a loose puck. The following are several examples with rulings to help apply the standard of play changes for 2016-17. This set of plays deals with puck carrier restraining. When the puck carrier is impeded by the illegal use of sticks on hands, arms, hips, or other areas that compromise their ability to control the puck and create offense, he or she must be allowed to play without exception. The Rules Committee believes that a player who has a positional advantage on an opponent through the use of physical skill and/or anticipation shall not lose that advantage through the illegal use of hands, arms, or stick. The puck carrier shall not have opportunities compromised by an illegal action, regardless of how slight. For example, if a puck carrier is impeded but still is able to take a shot on goal, this result does not negate impeding action. If the puck carrier was compromised, the call must be made. The following are several examples with rulings to help apply the standard of play changes for 2016-17. This set of plays deals with picks and interference. A pick is the action of a player who checks an opponent who is not in possession of the puck and is unaware of the impending check or hit. A player who is aware of an impending hit, not deemed to be a legal battle for the puck, may not be interfered with by a player or goalkeeper delivering a pick. A player delivering a pick is one who moves into an opponent's path without initially having body position, hereby taking the player out of the play. When this occurs, an interference penalty shall be assessed. The following is a good example to help apply this standard for 2016-17. The Rules Committee recognizes that embellishment is a tactic used in the past to take advantage of stricter enforcement initiatives. Coaches and conferences are urged to be cognizant of this tendency and address this issue immediately when observed. The NCAA standard of enforcement will continue to focus on simplifying the understanding of the standard and encourage a consistent, strict level of enforcement relating to impeding and obstruction fouls that take away a gained advantage. If the standard is enforced and supported, embellishment will be clear to officials and administrators. The following is an example of where embellishment must be enforced at all times.
That's total embellishment by Carcillo. Complete and utter fraudulent behavior.
This section of the video will cover the major rules changes passed by the committee for the next two seasons. A complete listing of changes is available in the rules book, which is available online at ncaa.org/playing rules. The preferred hash mark distance at the end zone faceoff spots shall be 5 feet 7 inches. By increasing the distance between the two wingers, the committee believes faceoffs will be cleaner and allow for more spacing. The National Hockey League has used this specification successfully. By making it the preferred standard, this continues to allow smaller specifications to be used, since many institutions do not own their own facilities. Goal pegs may be 8 to 10 inches in depth, and a limited waiver process will be available. In most cases, the goal pegs used range from 8 to 10 inches and adequately anchor the goal cage. Providing a waiver process for institutions that do not own their own rink or have unique facility challenges seems like a reasonable accommodation to the committee. Game officials and players must wear helmets anytime they are on the ice, with the exception of during the playing of the national anthem and post-game celebrations. The safety of participants is essential, particularly during warm-up periods when a larger number of players, pucks, etc. are on the ice. It is recommended that all players wear an internal mouth guard. After reviewing NCAA injury data and noting the limited enforcement of making mouthguards a required piece of equipment, the committee believes mouthguards should be recommended for all players to use. Intermissions shall be 15 or 18 minutes in duration. If a team chooses to use an 18-minute format, the visiting team must be notified prior to the contest with as much notice as possible. The 18-minute format was successfully used in some NCAA championships to allow for better ice conditions. By conference policy, if the game is tied after the 5-minute overtime period, teams may remove an additional skater for 3-on-3 for a second 5-minute overtime period. If no winner is determined after the second overtime period, the team shall utilize a sudden death shootout. Several conferences have requested the ability to utilize this procedure to award points in conference standings. The committee has been encouraged by the results of the experiment utilized last season by the National Collegiate Hockey Conference and is allowing any conference to use this format after the 5-minute overtime period. The video replay criteria has been adjusted to require a coach's challenge for offsides and too many men on the ice, except for the last 2 minutes of the game and any overtime periods. This stipulation will not apply to postseason competition. The committee is concerned about the growing number of replay stoppages in the game. In some instances, goals are incorrectly being overturned through the use of replay. In the postseason, however, the committee believes game officials should have the ability to review these areas due to the heightened importance of the games. As part of the video review criteria in postseason competition only, the committee voted to allow officials to review plays involving a penalty that would remove student athletes from the contest. For example, a game misconduct or disqualification. Officials are able to enforce any penalty as a result of the review. Additionally, officials may review potentially undetected penalties that would result in the enforcement of a major penalty. The importance of the ejection of a student athlete, especially in postseason competition, warrants the use of replay to ensure proper enforcement. This system was used experimentally the past two seasons during the NCAA Division I Men's Championship and some conference postseason tournaments. For a complete listing of our rules, please refer to the 2016-18 Rules Book, which is available online at ncaapublications.com. Thank you for your time and attention to this presentation. And on behalf of the NCAA, good luck on a safe and successful season.